At first sight, it might look a bit awkward to bring an archaeologist to a place like the DC3 to talk about past environment transformations and human environment interactions in the medieval and early modern periods. But I would say that for what I have discussed with you in previous times, that it's only in appearance because we have more concerns and more lines of research in common than we often think of. So what do I want to talk about today, and what's the focus of what I am going to present here? Well, as you can see, it's about landscape transformation, human action, and landscape transformation in the past on estuarine environments. Estuaries are a very sensitive environment to human impact, and that's why sometimes it's quite a good arena for experiencing how changes in human dynamics can affect natural ecosystems. But as an archaeologist, I work with the material record of past human action. So here I would say that the key word is possibly landscape. If you think of our everyday conversations, landscape is a word that we use very often. It's a very widespread word in everyday conversations, but we sometimes might not be aware of what we intend for these words. We use it just in a very general way. And the same happens with archaeologists. In the last 20 years, there has been a very great development of landscape archaeology, landscape archaeological research. But we do not always define landscape in a very precise way, which sometimes poses certain problems in the results we or in interpretations we may do. So first of all, I would like to define what I intend for landscape when I study this kind of topics. I have brought two definitions which I like very much. The first one is by Elisabeth Lewis, which was one of the founders of the French social geography in the late 19th century, who defined the landscapes like la nature façonnée par le travail, c'est-à-dire nature transformed by labor or transformed by culture. So it's how humans, by their everyday action, transform the natural environment, that transform the natural ecosystem, and this has as a result the landscape as a material layout. And a bit more poetic, but the same stands here in the poem by Miguel Hernández, the poet of the Spanish generation of the 1927, who, talking about the olive groves of Andalusia, defined them as the results of the combined work of land, labor, and sweat. So, bringing this to modern terms, we could say that landscape is the material result, the material product of how humans interact with the natural ecosystems and transform them. If we take this definition, we can distinguish different elements, different factors that participates, that interact in this landscape transformation, in the formation of this material assets. First of all, we should talk about the physical environment, of course, topography. For example, we can find in many parts of Europe or the Mediterranean, we can find this kind of terraced landscapes which are adapted to to labor, to agriculture in mountain areas with problems of erosion or problems of fertility. Well, this has been addressed by landscape archaeologists since quite a time. And we know that these kind of landscapes are very, very, how could I say, they are the results of very complex social and environmental histories. So this might be one example. The same stands for hydrographic adaptations. We can find different types of canal systems aimed at both irrigating or draining given environments. We can find also particular, it's Turing. Also, particular soil developments. This is a bit more debated in archaeology, but soils as well can be considered as social products, the product of social action, which leaves material traces in the environments we are studying. Besides the physical environment, we can talk about what happens with the biotic factors. We have many processes of selection, domestication, elimination, transformation of both plants, animal species, but this has also an impact on greater habitats and communities and transforms the landscape in the biological sense as well. And well, some examples of domestication and selection and how all these processes are reflected on the material layout of the landscape, on the land covers, for example. And the third group of factors would be the social dynamics, the social relations that shape these transformations. First of all, we should talk about how settlements are distributed in space, how also communications between these settlements are defined, how territories are defined around these settlements, how land is distributed, how land is managed, how all these resources are mediated by social relations, and the material imprints of these kind of processes. We can find them, for example, in the distribution of the parcel systems, the plot systems, which are have particular distributions, shapes, material elements related to different kinds of appropriation of this space. Well, we have that's a few examples, but this one, for example, is in Western England. It's a prehistoric plot system which possibly reflects a very decentralized appropriation of the space, whereas in Roman times, in Italy, for example, we can find plant parcel systems, which are very centralized decision making, the reflect of centralized decision making, or the same stands, for example, for medieval open field systems, which are the result of collective dynamics operating in the management of the agricultural lands. So different kinds of social relations, different kinds of social action have as a result different types of material imprints in the space. Another example is that of Saroyac in the Basque Country. Maybe some of you know them. They are particular parcels in the mountain that allocated to husbandry activities in the past, which have left this kind of particular circular shapes in the parcel systems. So I'm not going to get into the detail, but what I want to highlight by this definition of landscape as the result of human environment interactions from a material point of view is that these landscapes are in continuous transformation. They are subject to different dynamics of continuity and transformation at several scales. We have small scale, middle scale, large scale, both in space and time, and all that complex interaction of factors, agents, and scales is what shapes the landscapes that we see around us. So from an archaeological point of view, it's a kind of palimpsest. It's a word that we were using before, which can be disentangled from with our archaeological methods. So to illustrate this, I would like to talk about the specific case study of the estuaries of the Basque Coast, where the University of the Basque Country and the Aranzadi Science Society are carrying out or have carried out a research project over the last 3 years, from 2020 to 2023, in order to study how human appropriation and management of estuarine resources has transformed the estuarine ecosystems of the Basque Country and how the material imprints of those processes are recorded in the landscape today. Well, you know, with this, we have different estuaries in the Basque Country with very different landscapes today. We have some of them which are defined as natural reserves. The most known is probably Urdaibai, which is a UNESCO Biosphere Reserve, but it's also included in the Ramsar list of wetlands of international relevance. We have other estuaries, all those marked with the letters, which have been included in the Natura 2000 network. While we have other estuaries, for example, Muskis, which are not, which are very partially protected in the ecosystem aspect, and most of them are industrialized or urbanized at present. So it's a very different situation from one case to another. So how can we address this? I don't think I have to explain you how estuaries work. You know it, but what I want to highlight is that the natural ecosystems that we would find in a non-anthropized environment, estuarine environment, are not found in the Basque Country. We have different types of human interventions. Some of them are more intensive, like, for example, in the estuary of Bilbao, than, for example, what we can see in the estuary of Adur. But all of them have different traces of human intervention, including those who have been regenerated as natural marshlands, which is also a human intervention. So, how can we? So, yes, just to say that, needless to say that, this anthropization is facing very deep challenges related to the ongoing climate change and the eco-social crisis. So, this is a topic which is of interest not only for archaeologists from a historical point of view, but also from the point of view of how we manage, how we face these challenges, how we face these problems from the present day perspective. So, how can we analyze this anthropization of the estuarine environments from an archaeological point of view? How can we identify the different agents and practices involved in the formation of these landscapes? How can we trace their chronology, their rhythm, their consequences, their impact? Well, what we have done in the project Ribera, which I was mentioning before, is to select four of these estuaries, which are representative of the whole Basque Coast and have different kinds of land covers and different kinds of anthropic pressure at present, from Urdaibai in here in Biscay, which is possibly the most very anthropized estuary in the Basque Country, and also very protected from an environmental point of view, to the estuary of Bidasoa between Gipuzkoa and the French Basque Country, which is possibly one of the most affected because some portions are included in the Natura 2000 network, but most of the estuary has been subject to very heavy urbanization, industrial expansion, and consequent problems related to flooding, erosion, pollution, etc. So we selected these four case studies, and we proposed a local micro historic study based on five different data types of data. The first of them is the study of archival sources. This is one of the primary methodologies in historical research, is going to the archives and see what people in the past wrote about their everyday life. We analyzed different collections from local archives, from the selected case studies, to more general ones from state archives of both Spain and France, to ecclesial collections of the bishoprics of Pamplona, Bayonne, etc. And we created a database recording all those documentary references to human activity related to the estuarine environments. We labeled each reference with toponymic, chronological, anthroponymic, and also thematic labels. And we proposed an analysis, a diachronic analysis of how these records changed over time. This, for example, is the general picture. We have, of course, different volumes of data with different levels of reliability and representativity from case to case. For example, in Urdaibai, where we don't have a historical urban center which has acted as a central place for the Stuarian environment. We have very few records, whereas for the Bidasoa we have very, very expressive, strong records, and also very significant variations over time. We have different topics related to different parts of the estuaries or different activities changing in different ways over time. So we can reconstruct how the value of these resources changed for the local populations from time to time. So this was the first approach we proposed. The second one was the study of local toponymy. This is a very rarely explored aspect of landscape archaeology, but sometimes it provides very expressive ideas, because some past toponyms representing or reflecting past values, past activities, past land covers as well, are sometimes fossilized in places which where there is not any evidence of those practices or those land covers anymore. So we found many, many toponyms related to these three words: Ribera, Basadi, Itza, which is different dialectical variations of the same word, which reflect drained marshlands, that is, marshlands which have been reclaimed and appropriated for cultivation. So we see that even in places like Urdaibai, where today we have regenerated marshlands, we find these kind of toponyms, and we can infer or we can relate it to past practices of land reclamations, which so we can address also their extent and located them in a very precise way. Related to these three words, we have also these kind of words: Muna, Lubaki, Munto, Lezoi, all of them related to dikes or embankments or flood defenses aimed at controlling the floods or controlling the tides, or in any case, preventing these areas of from becoming flooded again, and therefore related to a permanent agricultural management of these areas. The third step was a field survey in each of the estuaries, where we recorded in a very detailed way the different land covers that nowadays are present in these places. For example, I have selected this picture because it's very illustrative. We can see all the different types of land covers in estuarine areas in just a very, very small geographic place. We can see natural marshlands, which according to the documentary sources, we can affirm that they have never been reclaimed. So they have always been natural marshlands, salt marshes. We have reclaimed salt marshes, we have polders, so former marshlands reclaimed for agricultural purposes. And according to the documentary sources, we can very precisely define when they were reclaimed. It was in the early modern period, in the 18th century, sorry. And then we have the third step after land proclamation, which is urbanization. So many of past former marshlands then reclaimed for agricultural purposes are nowadays urban and industrial ground. So we can affirm that in the 19th century, a very big deal of the industrial urban expansion related to the Industrial Revolution was operated on these kind of spaces. So we can see that there is also, so we can see how past human action, in this case, land reclamation with agricultural purposes, conditions for later developments. I don't know if. So, besides the land covers, we made a database of the material elements related to past human activity in these areas. We identified different types of flood defenses, some of them earthen, some of them reinforced with stone walls. We also documented the drainage systems from just very simple trenches to more complex canals related to the canalization of the tide dynamics. And also other types of elements related to other kinds of practices like light mills or fishing weirs or bridges or different types of elements. And with all this data, we created these georeferenced databases for each of the estuaries with the land cover and structure information concentrated in just one map. Of course, this is the present day layout of these estuaries, but thanks to the former work of documentary and toponymic research, we can relate it to specific phases in the evolution of these estuarine landscapes. So this is, as you can see, we have some of the estuaries like the Bidasoa on your left, which are very affected by modern urbanization and modern industrialization, whereas others like the Oria on your right are still very largely in the step of land reclamation with agricultural purposes, which was the rule before the Industrial Revolution. So we can also see how these different processes, these different dynamics affected differently to different environments due to their specific social economical conditions. The same for the other two estuaries. As you can see in the Urdaibai, we have the only case where marshes are at present the most widespread land cover, but again, this is not an intemporal and atemporal situation, but the result of conscious human decision, which has favored the regeneration of marshes from former polders in the last 30 years. So we can see another step after land reclamation, after industrialization. We are now in the step of regeneration and another kind of valorization of this kind of wetland environments. And finally, the last step was the recovering of sedimentary records from selected points in these estuaries. We selected both drained landscape, drained lands, drained polders, and regenerated marshes, like the one you are seeing here in Urdaibai, in order to see how all this activity, all these human hydrographical sedimentary factors are reflected in the layout of the sedimentary records. So we are nowadays analyzing these different core records. You can see how we get them. In this case, it is a core from polder lands in Hondarribia, in the Bidasoa estuary. The uppermost meter, you can see it is a cultivated soil, which is drained, which is nowadays used for maize cultivation and is a very fertile agricultural soil. But if we go beneath, we can see that we find this kind of very organic, very dark sediment, estuarine sediments, which were probably the rule before land reclamation, before drainage. So what we are seeing here, well, we are making different analyses and different measurements in order to define the stratigraphy of this course. But the main consequence that we are seeing here, just at site, is that land reclamation, that is the drainage of the internal waters and the prevention of tides to enter these lands, provokes a retraction of the water table and the creation of potentially cultivable, arable agricultural soils, which is actually the use that these soils have nowadays. So with all this information, all these different types of data, we are able to define how there are some general trends which are common to all the estuaries. And I would like to highlight two. The first one is that there is a spatial decalage in these estuaries. First of all, we have the most inner parts of the estuaries, which are less affected by tidal dynamics, which were drained, which were consolidated as agrarian lands quite early in time. Sometimes from the Middle Ages, sometimes from the early modern period in the 15th, 16th centuries, we have notices, we have documentary evidence that all these areas were colonized with this kind of dispersed settlements, dispersed farmsteads cultivating the former wetlands, which were already embanked, drained, and subject to manuring, subject to different kinds of activities to improve the quality of the soils. So we can see some of the oldest farmsteads in this case, this is Irún in the Bidasoa estuary. We can see that they are situated just on the edge of the floodable areas, but all these lands are surrounded by dikes, surrounded by flood defenses, and drained by quite reticular ditch systems. So this is one of the dynamics that we observe in all the estuaries we have studied. And then we have the outermost part of of each estuary, where dynamics seem to be quite more complex. First of all, because tide affects much more heavily to these areas. Second, because the salt marshes are were in the past subject to other activities rather than agriculture. And here we find different trends from one case to another. In the Middle Ages, in the early modern period, up to the 16th, 17th century, what we find is that these estuaries were very valuated for their port activities. This is the case, for example, of the Bidasoa, where Hondarribia, besides being a very military important place because it protected the border between Spain and France since the 15th century, it was also a very active commercial port. So keeping the channel clean, keeping the channel navigable, and keeping the port installation was priority for the local powers. And the rest of the estuary was subject to very extensive activities such as fishing, such as for fishing. I don't have. Yes, I have. For example, can you see Nazas de Francia? Can you read that here? Well, I don't know if I can. And can you see this structure, this V-shaped structure? That's a fish weir. That's a trap for salmons, for example. So these kind of fish traps, these kind of structures, which were wooden and very punctual, but were aimed at a very extensive activity, were common in this period. We have also some tide mills, for example, this one. We have the dike that traps the water during the high tide and uses it when the tide is low. So we have mills, we have fish traps, we have hunting activities, we have navigation, of course, we have port installations, but we don't have an extensive anthropization of the estuaries in the outer parts, at least until the 17th century. Instead, if we go to more modern times, what we find is that it's a radical transformation. This is the same estuary as we have seen. In the early 17th century, it was largely unanthropized. Whereas over the 18th century, what we find is that land reclamation, the embankment of larger and larger portions of the salt marshes, was advancing on the former wetlands in order to cultivate them. And we have documentary evidences from the early 17th century saying that the reclamation of this kind of wetlands was strategically important because it would provide land to cultivate wet, to cultivate. I have highlighted mijo. Mijo is barley, but it can also be maize. So I will talk about this later, but well. It would provide arable land for the population of the town of Hondarribia, which you can see there, which passed from being surrounded by water in the early 17th century to being completely enclosed between agricultural lands by the 19th century. And nowadays, as you can see, we have the airport, we have urban areas built on these former marsh areas, but we still have large parts of the polders quite well preserved, which permit us to connect the present day layout of the landscape to the historical, documentary, and cartographic records. The same stands for Irún in the neighboring If this is Saudi Arabia, this is Iran. Again, we have largely unaltered marshes in the early modern, or by the end of the medieval period. But over the 17th and the 18th century, we find both documentary and cartographic records which show how larger and larger and larger parts of this marshes were enclosed, were drained to reach the situation you can see in the aerial photograph of the middle of the mid 20th century, where all the former salt marshes were converted into agrarian lands. What's the situation nowadays? We have some small portions of regenerating salt marshes in these areas. We have some small portions of polders, but most of these former salt marshes and later polders have become urban land, with large parts of this town, this city of 60,000 people, living on former salt marshes. So we can see that anthropization has been very, very strong in this area. And again, we know that this happened in the 17th, 18th, 19th centuries, but why did it happen? Well, I thought it was highlighted, but I will find it. This is a decision of the local council in the mid 17th century, where they decided to drain all the inner parts of the salt marshes, and they say it is full of it is not useful today because it's not cultivated, whereas if enclosed and cultivated as it should, it could provide both wheat, maize, and other products. So what we are seeing is that there is an agrarian change. The introduction of maize in the early modern period, it is a crop of American origin, but we know that in the early modern period it was adapted to different parts of the southwestern Europe, and in the Basque Country, very particularly, it provoked a very sharp transformation of the agrarian landscapes. In the estuaries as well, it was a primary factor of colonization of these former salt marshes because it's very well adapted to humid environments, to mild climates, and these kind of spaces were very adapted to the cultivation of maize. So we see that this was a very important process in the transformation of the estuarine environments. Again, we can see how the introduction of the conversion of former salt marshes in agrarian lands retracted the water table. Permanently saturated estuarine sediments are found only beneath 1 meter depth, whereas the uppermost part of these soils is nowadays drained, dry, cultivated land with very strong evidence of animal manure, for example, liming to balance soil pH and other kinds of agricultural management practices related to the conversion of these lands to arable. Another case, this is Zumaya in the Urola estuary. Again, we have very, very expressive documentary and cartographic records which talk us about a planned reclamation of all the former marshlands in the late 18th century. We have these beautiful maps where we see how it was, how the estuary was before drainage and how it was after drainage. We see that main rivers were canalized, that salt marshes were converted into arable, and that this implies or this set the basis for later urban expansion. Indeed, if we look at the aerial photograph from the mid-20th century, you can see the result of this activity. All that big polder divided into straight
Parcels. Parcels.
yes, the long-shaped parcels divided by the drainage ditches. While in the 1980s, we find that large parts of those
holders have been occupied by industrial facilities, and by the early 21st century, we find a widespread urban expansion of those on those areas. So again, we can see how polarization, reclamation with agricultural purposes was the first step for a deeper and more intense anthropization in later times, especially during the Industrial Revolution. The same for the Oria estuary. In this case as well, we see how there are planned projects to reduce to culture, to reduce to agriculture, these former marshes that were used for hunting, for pasture, or for fishing. And again, we find how these soils are, now, are nowadays characterized by high levels of organic matter derived from manuring, and high levels of I don't know if it is here, not here, but we usually also find calcium, which is a remain of lime, which was a ethnographically well known practice aimed at improving soil quality as well. So we see that these processes are quite general. And then I have left for the end the case of the Urdai Bay estuary, because in this case, except for the case of Guernica, which is in the innermost parts of the estuary, what we find is that there has historically been a very much lower population density, and this has resulted in a lower anthropic pressure as well. In this case, we see that by the 19th century as well, most of the salt marshes had been drained for pastures for maize cultivation. Indeed, all the aerial photographs of the mid 20th century show us that the estuary was completely drained and completely cultivated. But in this case, since the communities placed around the estuary are much smaller, have a very small population density, the process has been the opposite. Instead of having been subject to urbanization, to industrial expansion, in this case, what we have is a progressive regeneration of the salt marshes, which has been favored from the 1918s onwards by the declaration of the biosphere reserve. So we see that human decisions, often dependent on socioeconomic conditions, have very, very different results in the present landscapes. So all this has raised many new questions, as of course. Some of them are historical and maybe are more concentrated to a historical subject, but I think it's important to mention how changes in how humans manage their resources over the long term have very strong environmental consequences. I think this is an idea that is worth highlighting. Especially, I would like to highlight the idea that the early modern expansion of the agricultural lands is related to the introduction of new crops, the introduction of the creation of new agroecosystems, and the establishment of increasingly intensive cycles of agrarian management, and how these transformations also, I have not mentioned very much, but this expansion of agricultural land can provoke the reduction of fisheries, the reduction of pasture lands, the reduction of common resources which were used by everyone in the past, and how this can also generate conflicts with the local communities. We have other consequences or other questions regarding the more environmental part of the processes we have documented. That is, how can we modelize, or how can we what can we learn from these long-term human processes and these long-term relations with the estuarine environments from the point of view of how we manage these areas, these environments in the present day context, where we do not have any more peasant societies, we do not have any more such a strong agricultural pressure, and instead we are facing the consequences of the rise of the sea level and the climate change, and etc. How all these past processes can teach us which practices, which relations were durable or not, or destructive. And then there is the question of how we use this evidence, how we use this material heritage, which is the landscape, to inform society, to inform the next generations on the on what we can learn from this process. So how can I valorize these landscapes from the point of view of cultural heritage as well? And well, just saying that we are now processing and publishing these works, the results we are getting are partially published in some papers. We have also done this divulgative book on the case of the Urdaibai estuary, which was presented last year and has resulted in the creation of some activities with the local schools and the local communities as well. So it has been quite nice. And we hope that we will continue in this line of deepening in the data we have and trying to socialize the results of this project. And I don't know if I have been very long or very short, but I hope that I said something of interest for you, and just saying thank you for your attention.
Now is the time. I don't know if you have questions or comments. Marie José?
No, te quería preguntar porque, bueno, muchas gracias por venir y por compartir todo con nosotros. Hay una cosa que me llama la atención en estos áreas costeras, ¿no? Que pueden ser o estuarios o bahías que acaban cerrándose como lagos costeros y que al final el proceso natural es de colmatación, es de adicionar sedimentos y al final ir ganando, o sea, la naturaleza va ganando suelo. Realmente las sociedades humanas lo que han hecho ha sido acelerar ese proceso muchísimo, ¿no? Y esto se ha hecho muchas veces con determinadas aproximaciones de gobernanza local, ¿no? Que han permitido que eso haya contribuido al desarrollo de las sociedades inicialmente rurales y con posterioridad pues, han ocupado ese terreno, como decías muy bien, pues, según el desarrollo de las zonas, puede ser la industria o puede ser el tejido urbano, ¿no? Entonces, ¿cómo vosotros valoráis esto, ¿no? Es decir, que es una aceleración de un proceso natural por parte de los humanos, que por supuesto no termina en el mismo punto, pero ¿hacéis algún o trabajáis con, por ejemplo, los historiadores y un poco comparando cuál sería la evolución de ese territorio con o sin, ¿no? Esa contribución humana?
Sí. Bueno, quizás una pequeña puntualización haría. Sí, es verdad que sobre todo el tema del drenaje y la reclamación sí que es una aceleración del proceso natural de colmatación en muchas de estas zonas, pero también nos encontramos que muchas veces esto iba acompañado y muchas veces era contemporáneo a procesos contrarios. Es decir, también nos encontramos muchas veces proyectos o reclamaciones de la necesidad de drenar de dragar los canales, de acondicionar las instalaciones portuarias, de enderezar las vías navegables, con funciones también relacionadas con el tráfico comercial, ¿no? Que tenían muchas de las villas portuarias. Entonces, como son dos procesos que se dan de manera contemporánea, eso hace que sea todavía más complicado, porque geomorfológicamente la consecuencia que tiene eso es que el influjo de la marea llega a zonas donde naturalmente no llegaría y se pierde en zonas donde naturalmente sí llegaría, con lo cual es muy, muy, muy complicado modelizarlo. De momento no hemos hecho esta comparativa, pero sí que hemos discutido mucho sobre el tema. Y, por ejemplo, en un proyecto que estamos empezando ahora, que nos han concedido para este año, En el caso del estuario de la Dur, que he puesto al principio, hombre, el Adur es un caso muy particular, no tiene mucho que ver con los demás estuarios de la Costa Vasca, porque es un río con mucho más caudal, mucho más largo, con, bueno, unas características muy particulares, ¿no? Pero sí que es verdad que hay dos fenómenos que son contemporáneos y que son muy interesantes. Y es que al final es, bueno, la villa de Bayona está situada hoy en día en la desembocadura del Adur, pero en la Edad Media no lo estaba. La desembocadura del Adur, después de cruzar Bayona, tiraba hacia el norte y toda la zona de las Landas era un larga flecha litoral, pues que prácticamente iba paralela al río, ¿no? De manera que el río desembocaba en el actual Capbreton, 30 kilómetros más al norte. Y hay un proyecto muy interesante, y además no es por parte de las autoridades locales, sino que es la propia monarquía francesa la que lo promueve, de hacer un proyecto de ingeniería hidráulica masivo para cortar esa desembocadura y crear una desembocadura directa para Bayona para que pudiera tener un puerto, pues, en el contexto de crecimiento de los tráficos transatlánticos de la época moderna, ¿no? Pues de la creación del imperio colonial y demás, pues necesitaba ese crecimiento comercial. Claro, esto se hace, si no me equivoco, en 1570 aproximadamente. Y paralelamente, en 1599, tenemos un edicto del rey Enrique IV que autoriza, que autoriza y que ordena a todas las autoridades locales del Reino de Francia a permitir la llegada de ingenieros holandeses y de inversores holandeses para que drenaran de manera masiva los las marismas de los distintos estuarios y de las zonas costeras de Francia. Y a partir de principios del siglo XVII nos encontramos con que todas estas zonas húmedas se empiezan a drenar de manera masiva. Es este caso que os he puesto antes. Este es el resultado. Claro, es una muy buena pregunta. ¿Hay alguna relación entre los dos fenómenos? Porque, desde luego, cortar los últimos 30 kilómetros del recorrido del río en su fase más distal y permitir un acceso directo desde el mar, pues transforma completamente las corrientes y probablemente provocó también un cambio en los espacios que eran afectados por las mareas y que seguramente pues entraran más hacia adentro y que seguramente esas zonas húmedas que hasta entonces se habían empleado como zonas de pasto extensivo pues eran en zonas más sujetas o más propensas a ser inundadas, ¿no? Entonces es muy interesante ver cómo un pequeño cambio en una pequeña actividad humana tiene consecuencias muy inesperadas en distintos, desde el punto de vista geomorfológico también, pero también del aprovechamiento de los espacios tiene consecuencias muy inesperadas. Entonces, todo esto para decir que no nos hemos puesto a modelizarlo en serio, lo hemos discutido mucho, pero es una cuestión bastante, bastante compleja.
Pablo, voy a adelantar.
Bueno, bueno, me ha encantado la presentación, me gusta mucho el uso integrado de información actual, información histórica, y es algo que yo también quiero hacer. Yo soy especialista en sistemas fastados. Y eso me ha parecido súper interesante. De hecho, creo que te voy a contactar para una cosa que estamos
Encantado.
pero también te quería hacer dos preguntitas. Bueno, una, ese uso que has dicho al principio, que las patrones circulares, si no lo conocemos, me gustaría que explicaras un poco más que tienes que marcar. Pero la otra cosa que te quería preguntar es, has hablado de los usos del suelo en los estuarios, pero hay uno que yo tengo documentado que es el uso por trashumantes, porque los pastos en carrizales, básicamente, eran muy apreciados en invierno, son pastos salinos, son pastos muy productivos y además, en una época donde no hay pasto en otros lados, ahí se podían meter los ganados. Y además entiendo que es un uso conservador digamos, con el sistema de referencia natural, que no implica transformación a un pasto de gramíneas, a un campo productivo. ¿Lo tenéis fichado o porque no has hablado de eso?
Sí, como transhumante no, pero como pasto sí. De hecho, uno de los ejemplos es el caso de Hondarribia, por ejemplo, que es uno de los casos más tempranos en el País Vasco, pues el siglo XVII, cuando empiezan a drenar para cultivarlas, hay una queja de los campesinos del entorno alegando que pierden su secular, derecho a pasto. Entonces sí que tenemos evidencias de que esas zonas húmedas se utilizaban, por lo menos las más internas, las menos impactadas por las mareas. Se usaban como pastos extensivos sin una antropización intensa. Y hay otro ejemplo también, en el caso del estuario de Loria. En ese caso es un poco particular porque todas las marismas situadas al lado izquierdo del canal pertenecen al monasterio de Roncesvalles.
Y hay bastantes registros que hablan de que Roncesvalles utilizaba los pastos de altura del Monte Andatx que está encima, pero también utilizaba las zonas húmedas como pastos. Y de hecho, a principios del siglo XIX, cuando el Ayuntamiento de Orio presenta el proyecto para el drenaje masivo de esas zonas, hay un acuerdo con Roncesvalles que habla precisamente de que Roncesvalles se vería perjudicado de los derechos de pasto que venía aprovechando y que por lo tanto se tiene que pagar menos. Entonces, sí que tenemos evidencias de estas prácticas. Es difícil encontrarlas en la documentación porque muchas veces son como consuetudinarias y no dejan una traza escrita muy intensa, pero a veces sí que por menciones esporádicas las podemos identificar. Y respecto a los seles, este es el ejemplo de Bermeo. Bermeo, Bermeo y Gizabulba, eso es. Y estos aparecen en las fuentes documentales desde la Edad Media. Se les llama, inicialmente se les llama bustanizas o pardinas, y a partir del siglo XV y XVI ya se les llama seles. Entonces son parcelas que están situadas dentro de los comunales, que tienen un mojón central y que a partir de ahí tienen una forma así como circular y que sirven para albergar el ganado, suelen tener bordas y demás en el interior, entonces sirven para albergar el ganado durante la noche. Entonces es muy interesante porque cuando nos encontramos que después de la introducción del maíz en los siglos XVII, XVIII y demás, cuando empieza a dispersarse el poblamiento, es decir, se empiezan a colonizar con fines agrarios también las zonas de montaña, los primeros espacios que se transforman son los seles. Entonces, lo que nos encontramos es que muchas veces dentro de los seles ya no tenemos una borda para guardar ganado, sino que tenemos un caserío que tiene una explotación agraria estable. Entonces, muchas veces, si te fijas, tenemos bosques, hoy en día son plantaciones porque luego también se privatizaron, pero en medio tenemos estos antiguos seles con un caserío en medio. Es una cosa bastante interesante también desde el punto de vista de la historia social de.
Y son circulares porque está en la borda en.
Son circulares, sí, porque tienen las medidas estandarizadas, entonces suelen tener un mojón central y a partir de ese mojón se tiraba a cuerda porque suelen ser zonas muy, muy accidentadas, entonces suelen tener esa forma. Estos son muy circulares, ¿no? Siempre son así, a veces se pierde más esa forma, pero sí, a veces se pueden ver. Y
Pero
luego
como
tienen
una
esas.
forma de delimitarlos, porque era
Sí,
más fácil delimitarlos así que delimitarlos.
eso es, eso es.
Bueno, no tenía satélites. Bueno, I have a question. And can you correlate any of this change, lack of change, with any conflict in the area?
Yes, in the case of Hondarribia, for example, conflict, you mean war? Yes. So this is a very interesting case because this was the border between Spain and France in the 16th century. And Hondarribia, as a walled city, was a very military, very strategic presence. So what we see is that, well, these kind of processes. First of all, well, Hondarribia was subject to sieges and attacks from the French part every time there was a war between Spain and France. It was so in the early 17th century, in the 30 Years' War, in 1630, I think. It was so in 1721, it was so in 1792, during the Confederation Wars, so it was subject to several attacks. During these attacks in the early modern period, what we find is that the processes of land reclamation are paralyzed in the border. So what we see is that the military authority takes over the civilian activities, and there are other priorities, and more or less they are paralyzed. We don't find neither planned projects for land reclamation nor permissions in particular to drain. So it seems that it was a kind of parenthesis between the process of drainage. The situation changes in the 19th century. Because the 19th century was a very particular period in Gipuzkoa, particularly, but also here in Biscay. And what happened is that the creation of the liberal states generated a widespread privatization of the common lands. Today, and in these provinces, in the coastal provinces of the Basque Country, there are very common lands in most of the places. So, this is a process that begins in the early 19th century, the Napoleonic Wars. the first permissions were granted to the municipalities to sell out their common lands in order to pay the costs of the French occupation or the duties came generated by the war. But what we see is that the later wars during the 19th century, the Carlist War, for example, in 1833, 1839, and 1872 to 1877, the new authorities, either liberal or absolutist, it doesn't matter, had a change in mentality. So they sought these processes of selling common lands not anymore as something which could not be done as it was before, but as a regular way to face the cost of the regular cost of the municipality. So in the 19th century, unlike the previous centuries, what we see is that the privatizations of wetlands and later drainages and renovations by the new owners accelerated during the war times. That's the 2 months.
But I guess what you refer is if there have been conflicts due to the within the local communities due to the relationship conflict.
Yeah, I'm interested to see
local conflicts. Yes.
Or changing the culture or change.
Yes, many local conflicts. Yes. Generally, we find that the reclamation projects were supported and sometimes promoted by the local councils, and we find resistances from the peasants very often because they saw this as a loss of common benefits like fishing or hunting, pasture or grazing, and a private gain for only those who could afford to buy these new lands. Indeed, what we see is that the lands that were reclaimed in this period were bought by the elites of each town, and then rented to poor cultivators in order to cultivate them. Yeah, so that as well we find this intra-local conflicts. Yes.
With that question, I have a question because are you been observing any emergency of particular governance structures that are trying to deal with these conflicts?
Not always. Not always. It depended on the local context. Sometimes we find normally where there was a strong urban elite, these processes of land reclamation and privatization of the wetlands were imposed to the local communities. Instead, where the peasants were stronger and they were not so strong investors or so strong central authorities, there was a larger place for negotiation and for common regulations of the wetlands. Even if they were privatized, we find in Arraibay, for example, we find that there were more duties for the new owners, for example, to permit the access of animals to graze after the cera was yielded, for example.
Yo solo tengo una pregunta que me parece muy interesante. Lo primero, esto. Y lo segundo es: ¿qué variables físicas tienen en cuenta? En el sentido de cuenta hidrográfica, solo el delta, en el sentido de que la variable física también puede influir en el comportamiento humano, en el sentido de que aquí no voy a construir porque sé que hay una inundación, o esos factores no los tienen en cuenta, solamente lo humano.
A la hora de hacer las prospecciones, sí, las prospecciones se hicieron en las zonas inundadas, definidas por o sea. Ahora, a la hora de analizar los asuntos documentales, es un asunto, porque las zonas inundables no son siempre las mismas y no siempre dependen de factores solo geomorfológicos, sino que hay muchas veces que zonas que eran inundables en el siglo XIV, por ejemplo, debido a la acción humana en el siglo XVII ya no lo eran. Entonces, ahí hemos tenido que tener una manga un poco más ancha. Pero a la hora de hacer la prospección, sí, nos hemos ceñido a las zonas inundables actuales porque sí nos hemos hecho.
Y en ese aspecto, si sabes que puede eso puede ocurrir, ¿puedes intentar relacionar la posible variable física de eso con el comportamiento humano posterior, o crees que el humano ha sido primero? siempre.
Si las. Me estás preguntando
Un
si,
sentido de
si los
normalizar.
factores físicos han condicionado la relación humana.
Claro, en una forma de normalizar diferentes
Sí,
tipos.
por
En ese
supuesto.
sentido, porque claro, el ser humano va a ser aquí porque se ha dicho a la derecha, manda uno, la izquierda manda otro, al final van a ser procesos diferentes, pero en el sentido de una forma de intentar unificarlo con factores físicos.
Lo que vemos en general, y en esto me remito sobre todo a los sondeos geológicos que hemos hecho, es que las condiciones geomorfológicas del estuario en el momento en el que se opera una actividad humana concreta están condicionando los límites de lo posible, ¿no? Entonces, la acción humana sí es en muchas, está, es, la agencia de las personas y de los grupos sociales es la que determina que se hace y que no. Pero dentro de un rango de posibilidades está dado por las condiciones naturales. Eso es indeterminable. Y de hecho, ese es uno de los factores que yo creo que explica por qué las zonas internas de los estuarios, como dices, se colonizan mucho antes y las más externas no lo hacen, hasta que primero el comercio transatlántico está empezando a entrar en un poco de decadencia, la entrada de cultivos americanos permite o hace rentable una inversión que antes seguramente solo para cultivación no habría sido. Se pierden otro tipo de actividades que antes, bueno, antiguamente habían sido muy rentables, como por ejemplo las ferrerías entran en decadencia en esa época. Entonces, bueno, hay una combinación de factores humanos y físicos, pero sí, por favor, los naturales, es, hay determinados umbrales que no se pueden pasar. Pero bueno, van variando.
Una forma de intentar normalizar el comportamiento humano.
Sí, pasa que es difícil modelizarlo. Es difícil modelizarlo, sobre todo porque tienes que tener en cuenta también la variable de fondo.
¿Sabes si el uso del maíz que se plantaba así en estas zonas era para alimentación animal o humana?
No lo he estudiado yo, pero los estudiadores que lo han estudiado dicen que desde muy, muy temprano es para alimentación humana. Sí, de hecho ya para principios del siglo XVII ya se habla de que el maíz se recoge en los diezmos y de que el maíz, y de que, vamos, se establece un ciclo de rotación trigo, maíz y forrajeras. El trigo se utiliza para pagar las rentas y los impuestos, el maíz es para alimentación campesina y los forrajes para alimentación animal. Son generalmente nabo, trébol, alolva.
Los palos eran originalmente de
Sí, se es harina de maíz. De
sí.
hecho, una de las cosas que no me he metido porque no tenía tiempo para todo, pero una de las cosas es que hemos observado es que precisamente en el siglo XVII empiezan a proliferar los molinos. Y además son molinos que, a diferencia de los molinos medievales, tienen dos muelas, uno para el trigo y otro para el maíz.
De cara a la adaptación al cambio climático, ¿cuáles serían tus reflexiones después de este estudio?
Yo, eso, sí, vosotros mucho más reflexionados que yo. Una de las cosas que sí que veíamos cuando decíamos este proyecto y sobre todo cuando hacíamos la prospección nos encontrábamos con que hay muchos espacios que son zonas industriales, esto lo hablábamos antes, son zonas industriales que hoy en día se han quedado abandonadas y que están sujetas a procesos de degradación, de polución, de inundaciones parciales, sí, pero no. Que están muy relacionadas con esta posición que tienen como zonas de ribera, ¿no? Entonces, una de las cosas que decíamos es que precisamente esto lo que nos permite ver es que hay distintos tipos de coberturas terrestres que tienen distintos tipos de comportamientos también de cara a las mareas, ¿no? Sin entrar en si las mareas van a ser más nocivas o no, pero frente a las mareas no actúa igual una marisma baja o una marisma alta regenerada. Un polder que tiene un sistema de regulación de aguas, ¿no? Por ejemplo, muchos centros de IP tienen una serie de canales de recolección que sirven para tener esos reservorios de agua sobrante hasta que baja la marea. No responde igual eso que una zona urbana. Entonces, bueno, hay distintos tipos, esto seguro solamente sería, habría que profundizar y habría que modelizarlo mejor, ¿no? Pero distintos tipos de coberturas y distintos tipos de usos tienen respuestas diferentes frente a las inundaciones, por ejemplo. Eso seguramente, pues. Sería una factura a tener en cuenta. No es lo mismo una zona urbana que un polder, tampoco es lo mismo un polder que una misma regenerada. No sé si
Entonces
por
entiendo
eso.
que lo que hay que intentar es regenerarlo, ¿no? O sea, regenerar marismas, eso es lo que. Aunque bueno, aquí es verdad que no sería una
una conclusión de este estudio, pero luego
Pues
sabes que hay alternativas.
podrías pensarlo, pero yo te preguntaría, por ejemplo, en una zona como Irún, ¿no? Donde tienes zonas urbanas muy densamente pobladas, porque tienes pisos de 10, o sea, bloques de 10 pisos en esta zona de aquí. Si tú renaturalizas completamente estos pólderes, ¿cómo va a afectar eso a esas zonas urbanas, por ejemplo?
Depende si te dejas que la marisma, claro, tienes algo, un contorno rígido, entonces es difícil que la marisma evolucione
Sí,
y si
yo
tiene que retroceder o lo que sea, es verdad, te la estás
no tengo muchos
imaginando,
conocimientos
pero
en temas de ingeniería y
ya.
demás, ¿eh? Pero sí, una de las reflexiones que hacemos es en este concreto, en estas, que son estas de aquí.
Sí.
Hoy en día esto funciona más, pero tampoco entre las marismas de la zona urbana.
Sí, de hecho se inunda este parque
Sí.
cuando hay. Sí.
Bueno, no sé. Sí, es un tema desde luego a
Vale.
reflexionar. Y de hecho creo que era un poco de uno de los objetivos de venir hoy aquí a contar estas historias.
Quizás la reflexión que yo hago es que a veces esa idea naive, ¿no? De volver al origen ya no tiene mucho sentido porque al final tienes que lo que tienes que procurar es que la regulación del agua, por ejemplo, en unas condiciones de mayor inundabilidad que te permita proteger las zonas urbanas, ¿no? Pero no las vas a quitar de ahí. Entonces, esa regeneración a un urbanismo original ha perdido un poco el sentido en ese contexto. Pues eso es lo que hay que reflexionar. Y luego, a mí lo que me enseña la charla de hoy es que entender la dinámica pasada es muy importante para poder entender qué soluciones son las que van a funcionar en el futuro. Y a veces, porque lo que comentaba, ¿no? Pensar en esas restauraciones idílicas de restaurar el catolicismo como era en el cuaternario, pues es así, pues no tiene bien, bien, no tiene. Bueno, ahora se va a restaurar parte, bueno, sobre todo por biodiversidad, bueno, por las aves, ¿no? Para darles más espacio, porque es una
Sí, esto ha
y
cambiado un
un
poco desde el
entorno
momento en que se hizo este
difícil,
mapa.
¿eh?
De las dos que veis ahí, la D23 sigue estando drenada hoy en día, la D24, que es la que está más cerca de las zonas urbanas, está ya en proceso de retención. Está dentro de la otra de las.
Claro, lo que pasa es que cambia las necesidades, ¿no? O sea, ya no te hace falta meter los barcos dentro de un
No, sí.
tren, ¿vale? Pero lo que no tendría sentido sería regenerar la marina. Habíamos empezado. Sería un desastre.
Sí, pero la amenaza del ascenso del nivel del mar está ahí. Entonces, tienes que proteger la zona urbana.
Pero
Entonces, bueno, en algunos casos estaría bien poder restaurar marisma y en otros tendrás que hacer un muro. Entonces, habrá que ver un muro de
no,
hace
un
mucho.
sistema de regulación que te permita
Sí.
claro. O lo mismo, por ejemplo, en
Sí.
el Adur, recomponiendo el muro natural que vuelva a esa parte de la zona, no se puede ser para. O sea, idea loca, ¿eh? Pero
Sí. Bueno, yo pienso en una desarrollo económico y natural. Es como ahora quisieras rellenar el canal de Suez, ¿no? O el de Panamá. Pero, a ver, yo creo que es una buena reflexión lo que como has planteado la charla, que hay mucha excitación en torno a las soluciones basadas en la naturaleza, que van a resolver todo. Y a veces nos olvidamos que parte de la naturaleza somos nosotros también. O sea, que tenemos que conocer las dinámicas. Y luego están las dinámicas sociales. Después me preguntaba yo sobre la gobernanza. Que a veces son procesos de gobernanza los que ayudan a solucionar y a poner soluciones encima de la mesa, igualmente importantes que los procesos físicos o la ingeniería.
Eso lo comentábamos antes con Elena, que cuando estuvimos haciendo las prospecciones en Urdaibai, por ejemplo, una de las cosas que nos tocó, porque no teníamos conocimiento de ello, es que, por ejemplo, la creación de la reserva de la biosfera y la regeneración de las marismas había sido vivida por muchas personas locales como un trauma.
Claro, no, pero nos
Entonces,
ayuda con la experiencia de Valencia, ¿no? De la fuera de Valencia, pues, la litoral, una restinga que se cerró y el lago se ha ido colmatando por aterramientos humanos que en algunos casos han durado varias generaciones para cultivar arroz. Y ahí ha habido un conflicto durante siglos de la comunidad de pescadores y la comunidad de agricultores. Y los procesos de gobernanza local han sido muy, muy importantes, por ejemplo, el tema de las aguas, la comunidad de pescadores y cómo se reparten los canales para la pesca, las cooperativas de agricultores. Y esos diálogos han sido fundamentales para mantener la paz, aunque ha habido algunos momentos en que estos han sido difíciles de resolver. Pero ahí, por ejemplo, restaurar el lago no se puede. Hay una actividad económica, lo que se ha hecho ha sido que esa actividad económica agrícola ahora mismo no utiliza pesticidas, procura preservar la biodiversidad en el lago, y hay un sistema de monitorización, son variedades más autóctonas. Y el problema no viene por la parte agrícola, que ha sido sistemáticamente el problema de lo que ha generado los conflictos, sino ahora mismo por la presión industrial de las áreas. Bueno, pues, por eso preguntaba, que yo creo que a veces nos olvidamos que nosotros somos parte de la naturaleza y que muchas soluciones tienen que tener un componente antropogénico necesariamente.
tenía alguna pregunta.
Sí, no, también agradecerte tu exposición. Yo no soy historiador, por lo cual también lo veo desde ese punto temporal, ¿no? Y bueno, tenía como una reflexión, pregunta que hacerte en base a lo que has dicho. Sé que está fuera de tu cronología, pero me ha dado la sensación cuando estabas hablando, ¿no? Un poco que planteabas que los dos, que una vez culminado el proceso de industrialización, ya que entra la desindustrialización, las dos salidas que se habían dado más normales será urbanización o renaturalización, ¿no? Por eso, si me equivoco, ¿eh?
Sí, en
Partiendo de
los
esto.
cuatro casos de estudio que hemos trabajado aquí es lo que hemos observado sobre todo.
Sí. Estoy pensando eso en las zonas que yo he trabajado, que estoy trabajando, que son Bilbao y Urdaibai. Desde luego, los ejemplos son muy diferentes. Porque en el caso de Bilbao, o sea, yo, a diferencia de lo que dice el compañero, ahí el peligro de la renaturalización no lo veo, porque me dice que está lleno de grúas y de cementeras, y en ese sentido creo que se parece más al proceso del siglo XVII de las élites locales apropiándose de esa zona del estuario, y basta con ver algunos apellidos que hay en las constructoras para dar cuenta de quién está ahí. Y bueno, y quería un poco también cómo esa desindustrialización, hasta qué punto afectaba, o pues se me he visto que afectaba, ¿no? Porque estoy pensando, por ejemplo, en que has dado una visión muy centrada de la morfología, ¿no? De la vida, que había cambiado un poquísimo en 100 años. Pero bueno, si pensando por ejemplo en la composición de esas aguas, de arena que tiene, contaminación depositada, hierro de manera muy clara, drenajes, canalizaciones. O sea, si teníais en cuenta ese tipo de aspectos, no solo morfológicos, sino también de composición del agua, de tipos del agua, de qué sustancias hay ahí, de cómo afectarse a la biodiversidad, etcétera, ¿no? Desde el interés que me produce, también viniendo como de vuelta de un campo que es el campo de la historia cultural.
No, no nos hemos metido en ese detalle, pero sí. Y además está relacionado con la morfología, te diría, ¿eh? Sería decir, sería interesante, por ejemplo, en el caso de Urdaibai ver cómo se relacionan esos procesos de los que hablas tú, ¿no? Desde el punto de vista de las aguas con los sedimentos. Cómo se relacionan, por ejemplo, con el corte de la ría que se hizo a finales del siglo XIX, cómo ha influido eso en la circulación de las aguas hacia el interior y a través de los estuarios.
La salinización, lo comentabas
Por
también,
ejemplo,
salinización.
sí. En ese sentido, es un proyecto parecido al que se está. No nos hemos metido de momento, pero
No,
todo
bastante
llegará.
analizado sería.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think this is, you have really showed us quite nicely that also when we're doing adaptation planning in this area, we have to take as basis not the current photo, but the last 500 or 2000 years of history. And I know from reading your your paper that you have been delving so deep into the archives of thousands of documents that you read or newspaper articles. So I understand that for Jung, like 1640, in one of these localities becomes very alive.
Mm-hmm.
And you understand, you see the different figures that are interacting and the discourses. And how can you make that more accessible to in general? Like, do you have a database of each locality of the 1,000 archive documents that you looked at and how they linked? Or
yes, no, it's not published, but we have an Excel database for each case. For each estuary, with all the documentary cartographic records that we have been able to identify. Yes, we can share and we can, but we are still publishing and we have not made public all the. However, I would say that, well, I didn't say, but this is the Riverak project. This has been funded by the Basque government. And the results produced, both the geodatabases, the document databases, and the geochemical data, have been deposited in the Center of Cultural Heritage of the Basque government. So I guess that as a researcher, they are available there, but we can share them as well.
So also you do quite a lot of dissemination work and work in the schools and education.
We try.
So we also said that another way of engaging might to be to do an excursion with you to one of these estuaries and to explain to us in the field.
Sure. Yes,
the
of course.
Past, reading the past in the field. And so thank you very much.
Thank you.